Hello everyone. Today we are going to start with the second part of atherosclerosis. We have already done the first part where we have defined what is atherosclerosis. We have also seen into the origin from where the word atherosclerosis comes from. And also we have seen into the risk factors or the causes due to which atherosclerosis does develop. It is very interesting to know about the pathogenesis of atherosclerosis and what is the exact mechanism involved in the development of atherosclerosis. As we have seen into the risk factors, there were certain risk factors which were changeable and there were certain which were unchangeable. The unchangeable ones were the age, gender and the genetic predisposition. Whereas the changeable were somewhat related to their lifestyles, also related to their habits of smoking, drinking and obesity. So let us look into the pathogenesis or the process by which this particular disease does develops. The pathology and pathogenesis of atherosclerosis can be understood by these three terms, or we can say these are the three terminologies or the stages through which we can understand the development of atherosclerosis. The first one is known as the fatty streak. Other is the fibrous erythematous plaque and third is complicated lesion. The later two, that is the fibrous erythematous plaque and the complicated lesion, they are responsible for the clinical manifestation or what are the symptoms associated with atherosclerosis. Those are actually manifested by these two stages, that is the fibrous erythematous plaque and the complicated lesion. This is a pictorial diagram. I hope you would be able to see this major artery where they have divided it into certain stages of life and also they have explained how the different lesions or different structures are formed in the process of this disease. So what they say is, according to the theory of fatty streak, there are two hypotheses made for the development of atherosclerosis. Out of these two hypotheses, the one is for the development of fatty streak. What they say is, from the first decade, see this column is defining the stages of life, that is the first decade, from third decade and from the fourth decade, that is 10 years of age, 30 years of age and 40 years of age. Here they have defined what are the main histological changes or what are the name of the stages. Like the first they have said the initial lesion, fatty streak, intermediate lesion, atheroma, fibroatheroma and complicated lesion. Again, here they have seen, told you about the mechanism by which these all stages will develop and also their clinical manifestation, that what all you can see in clinically. So let us start with the very first decade of life, this portion. You can see this artery is quite normal in structure. And what they say is, there is an initial lesion. Now what is an lesion? It is an, you can say this is a seat where actually this atherosclerosis might develop in the coming future. So they have said there is an initial lesion and some isolated foam cell. Now remember, this name of foam cell will come to the definition and formation of foam cell later. Then comes the fatty streak. There is some deposition of lipid in the arteries. This deposition of lipid in the arteries is known as fatty streak. This is usually present at the first decade of the life. Then comes the intermediate lesion. Intermediate lesion, you can see the age somewhat is the third decade or 30 plus of the age, where you can see now the intima layer is starting to deposit more amount of fat in it. that is intracellular lipid accumulation starts and small extracellular lipid poses. That is, you can see some lipid getting deposited here. Then comes again a later stage where the development of atheroma will start. This intracellular lipid accumulation starts. You can see the lipid, this yellow colored structure is the lipid accumulation. And later on in the fourth decade, what will happen is that is single or multiple lipid core. This is the lipid core present here. So you can see a single or a multiple lipid core present with fibrous deposit or calcified layer. That is fibrous deposition or calcification can also be seen. Furthermore, this atheroma or fibroatheroma may get complicated. That is like the surface defect. You can find a lesion at the surface. The lips might break off and it can cause thrombosis or hemorrhage at this particular location. Now, this occurs in the fourth decade. You can also see about the growth mechanism. From the first decade till the third decade, what is happening is growth mainly by lipid addition. There is only lipid addition to it. Whereas, what is happening here is increased smooth muscle. That is, in the formation of atherosclerosis or fibroatheroma, there is increased smooth muscle cell and collagen increases. Whereas in complicated lesion, hemorrhage and you also see thrombosis. So, clinically, the first three decades are quite silent. Whereas when it comes to the development of atheroma in the fourth decade and fibroatheroma and complicated lesion, they will lead into clinical features. Now, defining the pathology and pathogenesis, how exactly this process will occur. Now, we have learned about the development of fatty streak. This fatty streak is actually deposition of certain fats at the initial lesion that was formed in the first decade of life. These fatty streaks are thin, flat, yellow, intimal discoloration that progressively will enlarge to become thicker and slightly elevated as they grow in length. So, they are initial lesions, like you can imagine a streak of lip present on the intimal layer. Later on, when they will develop, they will grow, they will become thicker and slightly elevated from the surface. They do contain certain macrophages and smooth muscle cell that have become distended with lipid to form foam cell. Now, see, this is the definition of your foam cell. I said that foam cells will start depositing in the third decade of life. You see here that there are certain macrophages and smooth muscle cell which are becoming distended with lipid deposition. As we have discussed that there is some deposition of lipid and this deposition occurs in the smooth muscle cell and there's the term that is foam cell is used. Usually these foam cell will increase until the age of 20 years and they remain thick or they regress. That is, till 20 years of age, either they will, till 20 years they will grow. From 20 years to the 30th decade, what will happen is, to the start of the fourth decade, between that period, either they will remain static or they will regress or their number will become less. There is a controversy about the fatty streak in and of themselves are the precursor of atherosclerotic lesion. So, as I said, there is a hypothesis for development of atherosclerosis. That is, they say there is a possibility that atherosclerosis actually develops from this fatty streak. The other theory or the other hypothesis believes that there is some injury to the endothelial layer and that injury to the endothelial layer leads into development of atheroma. Now, what will happen to the fibrous atheromatous plaque is the basic lesion of clinical atherosclerosis. We have seen in that chart, we said that clinical manifestation of atherosclerosis only will start at this fourth decade where you will find that fibrous atheroma is developed. What are the characteristic features of this fibrous atheromatous plaque? it is actually having a accumulation of intracellular and extracellular lipid. There is a proliferation of VSMC. What is VSMC? Vascular smooth muscle cell, and formation of scar tissue. As there is an injury related to the development of atheroma, as one hypothesis is, so there might be a repair also, and that repair process leads to formation of scar tissue. The lesion begin as an elevated thickening of the vessel intima with a core of extracellular lipid, mainly cholesterol, which usually is complex with two protein, covered by a fibrous cap of connective tissue and smooth muscle. So if you are analyzing how the fibrous erythematous plaques looks like, so at the center core you will find some lipid deposition. This lipid deposition would be having the lipid, which one? That is cholesterol, and it may be sometimes or it is complex with protein. So it's a lipoprotein. It is covered with a fibrous cap. So usually these don't break up so easily, but in the later stages when the plaque will become larger in size, you will experience a rupture of this erythematous plaque. As the lesion increases in size, they encroach the lumen of the artery, eventually may occlude the vessel. Now I will go back to that slide to explain you what is happening. Just look at the artery. We have a cross section here, a longitudinal section of the artery. Now you'll understand this was the actual lumen of the artery. Now as this erythematous plaque is developing, the lumen of the artery is eventually getting thinner. So the amount of blood that would be passing through the artery will get reduced. So there is a reduction in the blood flow. Why there is a reduction in the blood flow? Because as the blood travels through the artery, this traveling of blood through the artery mainly is occluded by the presence of erythematous plaque. The more advanced complicated lesion are characterized by. Now the complicated lesion. What will happen is hemorrhage, ulceration, and scar tissue deposit. So where is this hemorrhage coming from? Since there is some leakage of blood in the extracellular fluid, also there is ulceration present on the plaque, and scar tissue deposition may also develop. Thrombosis is the most important complication of atherosclerosis. What is thrombosis? A part of this plaque may break off from the site of origin and may flow and occlude a blood vessel later on. It is caused by slowing and turbulence of blood flow in the region of plaque and ulceration of the plaque. So how this thrombosis actually develops is, as we have seen that the lumen of the artery was getting narrower, and due to the narrowing of the arterial surface, what is happening is that the plaque, diameter of that particular artery reduces, which causes turbulence of blood. As the blood to have a flowing pressure, turbulence will occur and lead into rupture of the plaque or breaking of a piece of a part of the plaque. Now to understand the mechanism of development. See, one mechanism we have seen, that is development of fatty streak. The other mechanism involved in the development of erythematous plaque is the theory of injury. What is the mechanism or the important points related to the mechanism? There is some endothelial injury with leukocyte adhesion and platelet adherence. That is, endothelial injury may occur, can occur due to hypertension, that can also occur due to certain type of metabolites present in the blood. Now, due to the injury and adhesion of platelets at that particular site, it will attract the very smooth muscle cell and they will proliferate. Lipid engulfment of activated macrophages may occur, and subsequent development of the atherosclerotic plaque with lipid core occurs. So overall, the mechanism lies the same, if we start with a fatty streak or we start with an endothelial injury, but later on all the sequences are same. It is the initial point where the fatty streak theory says it is from the first decade of life that the fatty streaks are present and they are the seed from on which the plaque might develop. Whereas the endothelial injury theory says that from the first decade of life there is nothing such, and eventually when the injury to the endothelial void wall might occur, that might lead to the development of plaque. One hypothesis of plaque formation suggests that injury to the endothelial vessel is the initiating factor. As I said, that the initiating factor in the development of atherosclerotic plaque is injury. Possible injurious agents are products associated with smoking, immune mechanism, that is your own immune system might be fighting or damaging the endothelial wall, mechanical stress which is related to hypertension, that is high blood pressure, conditions associated with development of this plaque due to injury are hyperlipidemia, that is excess amount of lipid in blood, particularly LDL, that is low density lipoprotein, with its high cholesterol content is believed to play an active role in the pathogenesis of atherosclerotic lesion. So what is happening is that hyperlipidemia, especially LDL along with cholesterol, should be present in high concentration so that your plaque might develop. Now to understand each and every agent involved in the development, first of all we will start with the LDL and cholesterol. Usually LDL is removed from the circulation by either LDL receptors or scavenger cell such as monocyte or macrophages. So this is a normal mechanism. Suppose if there is an excessive amount of LDL present in your blood circulation, how would they would be removed? Either by macrophages or monocytes. Approximately 70% of LDL is removed by the LDL receptor dependent pathway. Although LDL receptors are widely distributed throughout the body, 75% of them are located in hepatocyte, that is your liver. Thus, the liver plays an extremely important role in LDL metabolism. This is all what is we are talking is of the normal range or the normalcy of the body. Tissue with LDL receptors can control their cholesterol intake by adding or removing LDL receptors. So, in case if the circulating LDL is more, so the tissues can add LDL receptors and eliminate more LDL from the blood. If it's in the optimum level, they can adjust the LDL receptors accordingly. The scavenger cells, such as the monocytes and the macrophages, now the scavenger cells, they too have receptors for LDL that have been oxidized or chemically modified. The amount of LDL that is removed by the scavenger pathway is directly related to the plasma cholesterol level. When there is a decrease in LDL receptor or when the LDL level exceeds receptor availability, the amount of LDL that is removed by scavenger cell is greatly increased. So what is happening is, although there is a mechanism present for removal of LDLs in the hepatocyte, but in cases if there is some hepatocytic injury or in cases where the amount of LDL has been increased many times as compared to the receptors present on the LDL removing mechanism, then these macrophages and monocytes, which are scavenger cell, will ingest, remove or engulf more of LDL. The uptake of LDL by macrophages in the arterial wall can result in accumulation of insoluble cholesterol ester, the formation of foam cell and the development of atherosclerosis. So again we have came back to the foam cell. I have added a point to it. How does foam cell forms? We have seen that foam cells were actually the macrophages and monocyte engulfing lipid. Why they are engulfing? Because they are the scavenger cell and the quantity of LDL present in the circulating blood has increased to many folds. One of the earliest responses to elevated cholesterol level is attachment of monocyte to endothelium. Now what is happening here is that your monocyte is getting attached to the endothelium, the monocyte emigrates through the cell-to-cell attachment of the endothelial layer into the subendothelial space, where they are transformed into macrophages. Activated macrophages release free radicals that oxidize LDL. So, the monocyte will emigrate or by the cell-to-cell attachment of endothelial layer into the subendothelial space. Well, they will transform into macrophage. What macrophage will do? They will release radicals which will oxidize LDL. Oxidized LDL is not recognized as a cell receptor level, so it cannot be internalized and it longer remains into the bloodstream. Oxidized LDL is toxic to the endothelium, causing endothelial loss and exposure to subendothelial tissue to blood components. This will have a chemotactic effect on lymphocytes and monocytes. They will attract more of lymphocytes and monocytes. It has chemotactic effect on smooth muscle cell from the arterial media and stimulates production of MGCSF. It's a stimulating factor for division, cytokines, adhesion molecules in endothelium. This in turn, it inhibits endothelium derived releasing factor EDRF, favoring vasospasm. This will in turn stimulate specific immune system, that is production of antibodies against oxidized LDL. Now this oxidized LDL endothelial disruption leads to platelet adhesion and aggregation and fibrin deposition. So endothelial disruption leading to platelet adhesion and aggregation and fibrin deposition. Platelets and activated macrophage release various factors that are thought to promote growth factor that modulate the proliferation of smooth muscle cell and deposition of extracellular matrix in lesion, elastin and collagen proteoglandin. So we are seeing there are many things present. It is the foam cell which is present, it is the smooth muscle cell which is present, also it is having elastin, collagen and proteoglycan. So sometimes it is referred as the porridge. Porridge is means they are a mixture of many things. Now these activated macrophage also ingest oxidized LDL to become foam cell, which are present in all stages of this development of atherosclerotic plaque. Lipid release from necrotic foam cell accumulate to form the lipid core. Now further what will happen, the macrophages which has ingested this lipid will necrotize and release the lipid and form an unstable plaque. Connective tissue synthesis determines stiffness, calcium fixation and further ulceration of atheromatic plaque. So if there is a good deposition of connective tissue, the chances of ulceration will get less. If there is less, then it will become more. We'll continue with the mechanism of formation of atherosclerosis in the next part of atherosclerotic plaque, atherosclerosis. Till then, thank you.